Support for Wavemakers comes from listeners like you and the Tampa Bay Times. The Pulitzer Prize-winning newspaper is available around the Tampa Bay area and online at tampabay.com. Thanks to the Tampa Bay Times for their support.
Good morning and welcome to Wavemakers with Janet and Tom, a weekly conversation with people making a difference in the Tampa Bay region. I'm Janet.
And I'm Tom.
And running the board for us today is Tampa voter John Dunn. Answering our phones is DJ Spaceship. If you want to join our conversation, as always, you can call us at 813-239-9663 and DJ Spaceship will get you through to us. You can also email us at dj@wmnf.org or text us at 813-433-0885. WMNF's Fall Fun Drive begins in 2 weeks. It is not too early to start donating. If you enjoy Wavemakers, we'll be asking for your support on September 3rd. But it's, again, not too early to start donating. We have lots of fun thank you gifts to offer and an $1,800 goal to reach. You can donate right now by going to WMNF.org.
Our guest today has been making waves in the Tampa community for decades, especially in the past year as a member of the Tampa City Council and chair of the Community Redevelopment Agency, the owner of Black English Bookstore in Tampa Heights. We spoke to her briefly a few weeks ago during a show about the recent comeback of independent bookstores. So we invited Gwen Henderson back to broaden the conversation to some issues she's been championing. Welcome to Wavemakers, Gwen.
Thank you for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
It's
I appreciate
great to see
it.
You
good
here
morning.
In the studio. First, though, we want to mention that this is the last day to vote in the primary elections throughout Florida and the Tampa Bay area. Polls are open until 7. WMNF has created a handy voter guide online where you can find information about candidates, look up your polling place, and even register to vote. You can find it at wmnf.org/vote. If you're not registered already, you won't be able to vote today, but you'll be able to cast a ballot in the November general election. Some elections are based on party affiliation, but judicial and school board elections are nonpartisan and open to all registered voters. Gwen, you spent your professional career as an educator. Are you following the school board races this year?
Absolutely.
And
100%.
Have you voted?
I've already voted very early.
How important is this year's school board races, would you say?
Well, you know, all things are local. So local government is very important, especially the school board. As an educator, you know, there are opportunities to agree and disagree with board members. But at the same time, our end goal is to do what's in the best interest of our students that we serve every day.
And coming up in the fall, there'll be an important matter on the ballot. Hopefully, we're hoping in November with the school district. Talk about that, Gwen.
Yeah,
is that important to you?
I am so glad that you actually asked me that question, Janet, because we just received our bills in the mail, our property tax bills, and you know, it kind of indicates what you would pay if the millage passed or if it didn't. And you know, for me, it's going to be for two properties, it's going to be about $150. And so I really want people in our community to seriously take a look at, you know, what they're going to be providing to Hillsborough County Public School teachers. We are way behind. And just because you're asking me, I really want to be very personal about this millage increase and why it's so necessary. Entering the drop program as a retired educator after 30 years, 3 college degrees, my average salary is $56,000.
Oh my
when
goodness.
You translate that to 1996, I came out of college in 1986. In 1996, my brother graduated 10 years after me. His starting salary in 1996, I still don't make that today as an educator. And so it is really imperative that people understand that. And I came up in a different time. So kids today, you can't afford to live. It would be fiscally irresponsible to major in education because you know coming out of the gate, you're not going to make money, and you're not going to make money consistently where you're going to get well-deserved increases. So it
is.
And
yet it's probably one of the most important professions in our society.
No, it is the most important profession in our society. And everybody agrees. Everyone says, yes, teachers deserve to make more money, and no one's doing anything about it until we ask for something. And so this is really not a matter of have and have nots. There are a lot of teachers that go without, a lot of teachers that spend their own money. I am one of them. And, you know, they deserve to have a quality of life, especially because the requirement requires you to pass a professional certification, because it requires you to have a college degree. You should be competitive coming out of college with a pay that is deserving where you can live.
And from, is this millage for salaries?
Because it is directly for salaries, and it's a $6,000 increase. So in Hillsborough County, our starting salary, I think, is about $45,000, $46,000, $47,000. And that's sad in itself. Our kids can leave high school and go make that at Amazon. You know, so yeah, it's going to increase the salary, and that's exactly what it's for across the board, because everyone is deserving. So, you know, if that's our pay, you know what the lunchroom workers and our custodians and our other support staff, you know, are going to be compensated as well. And it's long
overdue. In Hillsborough, they're behind other counties,
yes,
right? And they're losing teachers.
That's right. That's right. So if you're competing with St. Pete and you are getting the College of Education major, the teacher who studied to be an educator, if you're competing for those trained professionals their first year, and the surrounding counties are paying more than you and it's cheaper to live in those counties, yeah, you don't have a chance. So we have to be competitive. We're one of the largest school districts in the country, I think the seventh or eighth largest school district, and we do some very innovative things, and we, you know, need this millage increase.
And the millage increase is going to be on the ballot.
Because it is on the ballot.
An appeals court just ruled, I think, yesterday.
Exactly.
That the county commission was wrong when it tried to block the referendum.
Right. And that's a conservative body. And so that's exactly why it failed, because they're a conservative body. And so,
what, they don't believe in letting the voters make their decision?
You know what? That's exactly what it looks like.
We've got an email from Jackie in Clearwater, and she's asking a question. I'm not sure it's a rhetorical question, but Gwen, you can take a chance, stab at answering it. She says, why is Florida fourth in GDP, yet we rank 50th in teacher salaries and 49th in per pupil spending? Any thoughts on that?
Well, the investment in education doesn't start at the local level. You know, everything, the decisions that are made by people outside of education are the folks that make these decisions about our funding. And so the FTE is low, so therefore, you know, the salaries are going to be low. And when you look at it from, if you compare someone like a metropolitan like Atlanta, if I still lived in Atlanta, I would be retiring right now at 30 years at $115,000, $117,000. Not 66. So retiring at 66,000 versus retiring at 117,000 is the difference.
Right.
And and let me even blow you this way. The state of Georgia in Atlanta, the starting salary is 63,000. They pay state taxes, but the cost of living is, you know, just about the same. I think it's a little bit more here. So we don't make the decisions. I think that society would pay us. I think everyone, you know, agrees that we're deserving. And out the gate, we have to be competitive with our salaries, and we're just not. So that's why colleges of education are closing on university campuses. People aren't majoring in education.
Mm.
I have to say,
I briefly considered being a teacher, and I did an internship for about 6 weeks at mm-hmm. Title IX school or Title I
Title
school,
One. Mm-hmm.
Title I school, and decided that was too hard.
Yeah.
That is some hard work.
You know what? I served as a department chairman at my alma mater, Jefferson High School. Shout out to Jefferson Dragons. And there were two teachers starting, and let's say it was maybe about the fifth, sixth day of school, and they were standing at their doors, and I was walking by them, and I said to them, I just looked at them and I paused. I said, y'all thought it was easy. And they started crying. It was so funny.
Yeah.
Because it is tough. And I had to say, get you some rest. Stop taking it home. You know, just trying to give them some boundaries, even though I don't listen to those boundaries myself. Teachers work very hard. Very, very, very hard.
Oh, yeah.
My personal lifestyle is just ridiculous when it comes to my career as a professional. And I would not want people to follow that. I would not consider that good advice.
You're listening to Waymakers on WMNF with Janet and Tom, a weekly weekly conversation with people making a difference in the Tampa Bay region. And we're talking to Gwen Henderson. She is a member of the Tampa City Council and chairperson of the Community Redevelopment Agency. So we were talking a little bit about elections. The big election, of course, is in November, and millage increase will be on the ballot. But let's talk a little bit about the presidential race.
Yeah.
And last night was the first night of the Democratic National Convention. I'm assuming that you watched it, and tell us what your thoughts are on this.
Did you stay awake
election.
For the whole thing? Because Janet was having a hard time.
I couldn't make it. I just kept yelling out from the bedroom. Who's on now?
Okay, you can tell that I'm clearly heading toward 60 this year. I cleared my slate as a councilwoman. I am not available this week in the evenings. I am going to be glued to the television, and I'm so excited about where we're headed as a Democratic Party. Kamala Harris being at the top of the ticket is very, very, very special, not just because she's a Black woman, because she is a woman, period. It is time for us. It is not glass. It is marble. We've tried to break through. It started with Shirley Chisholm in 1972, who happens to be my sorority sister. Shout out to Shirley Chisholm. She paved the way for this. And so it's been a long time coming, and I am thrilled that Joe Biden, let's give some love to Joe Biden. Joe Biden put Kamala in a position by selecting her as the vice president. And like he said last night, that I actually heard this morning because I didn't hear it last night. I fell asleep on you, Joe. I'm sorry. I'm going to go
back
and watch
it. They were showing him the love last night.
They did show him the love. I fell asleep in the middle of the love. But he put her in position by placing her as the vice president. And then in that was his best decision. But then I believe, in my opinion, working with her really sealed the deal. And so it was easy for him to put his support behind her. And it took a lot of courage, of course, for him to do that. In the next 5 months, of course, he's going to get a lot done. But this ticket with not just Kamala, but a teacher, Tim Walz, a football coach. I'm wearing my state championship ring. I threw it on for y'all today. Y'all see that?
That's a big one.
Yeah, that's a state championship ring, Jefferson High School. And so,
what year is that? What year was that?
This one is 20. I have two state championship rings. This is the 2018 ring, okay. And I have the 2010 ring from football. And our baseball team won in 2018.
Excellent.
Yes, and I have both
rings. So you went
to
school there, and then you ended up
working there.
That
is correct.
Oh, that's cool.
that's right. That's right.
So having a teacher at the top of the ticket
okay,
also.
Okay. Yeah. Well, who was a teacher? I think Lyndon B. Johnson was a teacher for maybe about a year, but a real teacher, someone who spent years in the classroom with kids, his kids encouraging him to run for office, and just that coach mentality. He's worked with young people. He is the person that decided, you know what, everyone in the state deserves a free meal, you know, made lunch free for his kids. That's really important. I could tell y'all some stories, but this is a short radio show, because we're the front line. We see what these kids, need, and that meal may be the only meal that they have that coming into their body. So it's really important, the decisions that he's made as a governor, just being out of the classroom, is very exciting for me. I'm really excited about this ticket, not just Kamala Harris, but Tim Walz as well. And he's handling himself very well.
One of the things about Kamala Harris is that she is a member of a Black sorority. She went to Howard University.
That's right. Shout out to Howard University. I'm a Howard mom.
Now, you are a member of Delta Sigma Theta.
Oh, you did your homework. Yes.
I'm trying to do a little bit of homework.
Yes. I am a member of we call it the Divine Nine, which makes up the nine Panhellenic Greek organizations. Most of them started at Howard University, one at Butler University, I believe Indiana University was one as well. But Alpha Kappa Alpha was founded in 1908 at Howard University, and Kamala Harris is a part of that sorority. And the organizations, although we do not politically endorse, we are politically involved. And so that is a powerhouse within itself, because we're not just a Greek letter fraternity and sorority in the traditional sense, like, predominantly white fraternities and sororities. Our work continues at the graduate level in a very, very high, large way.
But after college, beyond.
It's a lifetime commitment, because it's really about public service. Although, we're represented individually, there collectively we do a lot of things that are beneficial to our community. community because we are the college-educated bunch. Probably a lot of us were first-generation college students. So this is millions of people within an organization that is, you know, behind this particular campaign for...
But you're saying there's not an endorsement, but you talk about the...
Right. You can you support individually, but our organizations are nonpartisan.
Okay, so as an organization, you don't endorse.
Yeah, exactly.
Gotcha.
Exactly. We're not in politics in that way. Political awareness and involvement is a part of our business and what we do as a community organization and sorority because we are about public service. So we'll do the voter registration. We will keep people informed. We will canvass neighborhoods and get people to register to vote.
So is your sorority and the others in the Divine Nine, are you sensing, is there some activation going on right now?
Yes, there is huge activation. You know what? You just happen to be talking to the mother of the regional coordinator for the Kamala Harris campaign.
Oh.
Yeah, so shout out to Ariella Mira Danley. She's over there at the Democratic office in Temple Terrace. She was hired to be the regional coordinator for the campaign. And to answer your question, you know, she's responsible for making sure all the mobilized events happening in the Bay Area are publicized on their website. And there is this Saturday a huge rally of women from the Greek letter organizations. About 1,200 people have registered so far. I'll be there. The mayor will be there. It was supposed to be at the Skills Center. I don't know if I'm at liberty to say where it is because I found out this morning and I could see that she hesitated when she told me. So I don't know if it's official. They're going to be sharing that. Yeah, everything is very securities days too.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, security is important as a part of this election, for people like us.
Did the mobilization start after Joe Biden stepped down? Were you activated like this for Joe?
That is such a good question, Janet. Black women lead. Did you hear about the 44,000 black women call?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I was on that call. Very emotional and exciting. You know, you could shed some tears, you could laugh, you could cry. It was a very wonderful thing. We had been meeting for 4 years. And so it just didn't start because Kamala was nominated. Yes.
But there's a bigger fire under you.
It's
now.
A bigger fire. Yeah. And really, Janet, I know you can relate to this because we're grown women. When you find your way and you have your voice, we are stronger as a group, and we know that. And so we have to lead by example. And that's why, you know, there are a number of women running for office. I'm inspired to run for office. I bought a book, and it was really for young people. And so... you know, you have to put yourself out there, and it's easier to do that when you're not afraid.
Okay, you have a support system.
Yes, exactly.
People around you saying go, cheerleaders.
Exactly.
And your sorority was behind you.
You know what? My sorority was behind me, but also surprised. You know, like, Gwen, really? I'm like, yeah, girl. Yes. You know, so, yeah.
Weren't you president of the local chapter?
No. I was the scholarship chairperson for 10 years in my chapter. My political strategist, shout out to Jamel Lani, she is a member of my sorority, and she was my campaign manager by trade, graduate of Florida A&M University like myself, and she just got on the call and decided to help me. So really, it's about the sisterhood. You know what? I want to help you. What do you need? I want to help you. So that's how it started.
Why is it that the black sororities, though, continue in this way, and you all had done all the things that you talked about, voter registration drives? I'm not aware of white sororities and fraternities doing that kind of thing. So what is it in the black community tradition that has prompted this kind of activism and continuation way past college?
Well, you know, we were founded in the early 1900s, you know, at a time when, you know, they were hanging banners saying that a man was lynched today.
Yeah.
You know, so we come from that era at a time where my sorority in particular, the very first thing that they did as an organization was march in the suffrage march. And they were afraid, but they had courage, and they were relegated to the back of the suffrage parade. Black women, really, white women didn't want them to participate, really. But Ida B. Wells had something to say about that. She marched with her delegation. So really, that was kind of like that was the start of my sorority's first public act. And so as educated black people of that time in the early 1900s, really, this is just an extension of fighting for your community, doing what's best for us, not just as a society, but even as women in particular. What do we need? And that's where it started there, having our voice, which we still didn't get the vote until, you know, the Voting Rights Act. Really, black white women got the right to vote in 1920, but we did not. That fight had to continue. So that means the work of our Greek letter organizations had to continue. And all of us, we have different routes getting there, but public service is the primary goal.
Okay. And I think this could be said for the black fraternities, right? I think
absolutely. I don't know if you all were paying attention. Did you see a lot of purple and gold in town a couple of weeks ago?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. That was Omega Psi Phi fraternity.
That's right.
Their 84th Grand Conclave was here, Conclave with a Purpose. They bought about 11,000 books to give out to our kids, a lot of them banned. Appreciative of the fact that they supported Black English Bookstore, which I, you know, opened up in December, a brick and mortar over in Tampa Heights. So they landed in town about 40,000 strong for their 84th Grand Conclave. All of us have national conventions to lay out our agendas to continue with our individual purposes. And every president of the Divine Nine also comes to these conventions. So we have a huge public meeting. You invite the public and you let the community know, hey, this is what we're here for and this is what we're doing. And so, yes, the men also are a big part of it.
Sounds like a serious group. You guys are, activism is sort of in the DNA of these organizations. Not just keggers and little social soirees.
You know what? I don't want to dismiss the fun of Greek life at the collegiate level, but all of us have agendas and that is important. But our sororities and fraternities fun as well. Yes, I've gone to a couple of parties myself, you know, as a kid. And even as an adult, we do fellowship. That is a part of it. But the work and the purpose of what my founders did, in particular 22 women, what they did really is the reason why I'm a member of this wonderful organization, along with, of course, my favorite teacher from high school, who is a member of my, you know, sorority. Shout out to Miss Levins, Thomas Jefferson High School, you know. And so, yeah, it is important. And that exposure, even for me as a teacher, I have students now that are part of my sorority because, you know, they were introduced to it simply because I had a banner in my classroom. You know, what is that? You know, or they're invited to participate in our community events, become a part of, you know, our activities that we do, our Delta Academy, our Delta Gyms programs, an Embody program for boys. So, yeah, I could go on and on about that. And that exists across the board in all of our fraternities and sororities. We have young people that we work with in our schools and in our community. And we also give out scholarships. You know, we gave out over $100,000 in college scholarships. Very proud of that. As the chairperson, that was one of my favorite things to do.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Let's go to the phones. And if you want to call and ask a question or comment, tell us what you think about the election, what you think about the convention so far, Democratic National Convention so far, give us a call, 813-239-9663. Or you can send us an email to dj@wmnf.org. DJ Spaceship will take your call if you call. He says he went to Jefferson, too. So we got another
DJ
Jefferson alum in the house. Okay, Jamie in St. Pete, you are on the line. What is on your mind?
Yeah, hi. Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Jamie. I am listening from St. Petersburg. I appreciate the discussion. I just wanted to call about this whole question of the participation of African people or the black community in the democratic process. You know, that is something that people fought and died for in the 1960s. The right just to be able to vote or just to be able to register for the Democratic Party, something, of course, that Fannie Lou Hamer was
sick and tired of being sick and tired.
So, you know, I wanted people to know that that struggle continues to this day. I think that it's really important to say that the case of the Uhuru 3 is coming to Tampa on September 3rd, and this is a case of freedom of speech and the right to vote and participate in elections by the black community. versus the federal government's attempt to crush that by imprisoning Chairman Amalia Shetella, Penny Hess, and Jesse Neville, who are three activists, tied to the African People's Socialist Party, which is an organization that goes right back to the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and the heroic struggle of the 1960s for democratic rights for African people. And, we're currently in this thing called Freedom Summer 2024. This is a project to make sure that people are aware that the federal government is currently trying to imprison these activists. And if they are successful in doing that, it will effectively be the end of the First Amendment as we know it. And, one of the things that they're coming after these activists for is running for local government. Aretha Akile Canyon is a candidate for City Council District 7 running right now in St. Petersburg. And she was one of the targets of the original FBI raids of 2022 that happened here in St. Petersburg that not enough people know about.
Right? Well, Jamie, we appreciate the call. Thanks for calling.
And that trial, just to clarify, it comes up September 2nd, right?
September 3rd. And August 31st, there's a rally at the Uhuru House, not one step back, where Jill Stein will be there, Cornell West, the Uhuru 3. We call on people to come to the Uhuru House, 11 a.m., Saturday, August 31st, 1245 18th Avenue South. Show your support for the rights of free speech and participating in the electoral process by the Black
community. And that's next Saturday.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks for the call, Jamie. Appreciate it. And I assume you voted, right?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, thanks so much for calling.
Thank you so much.
So that was somewhat of an announcement, but, voter suppression still does exist in our society, and we have to fight the ravages of that every single day, Jamie, so I appreciate the work that you're doing. Free speech, everyone has a right to free speech, and it should their voices should not be suppressed, so I agree with you there, and I wish you all well in your efforts over in St. Pete.
We got an email from Dave, Mr. White Pepper Bryant. And he says, for listeners who don't know, Florida now has a Divine Nine specialty license plate.
Yeah, I have one on my car. I have one on my car and my golf cart. Yes, I do. And I was one of the first people to sign up for it. So, I can't wait to see. I believe Delta Sigma Theta probably has the most license plates sold in the state of Florida.
Not that there's a competition.
Yes, there is a competition. Don't think that we're not competitive. We actually have Greek games every year where we play athletic games against one another every year. So,
there's money for those. Plates go to scholarships or do you know?
Well, state of Florida, so there's some, the funding goes somewhere, I don't know exactly if ours goes to DREV, maybe each individual chapter decides where theirs goes, but we support the Florida tag, so I had to give up my Buccaneer tag. That was hard, but
I think you made a good choice.
Yeah, I did it.
David has a question, actually, and he says, what does your guest think about ADOs? I do not know that acronym, sorry.
Yeah, what does that mean?
I don't know, but it says, and how folks in that group think, David, if you want to follow up and tell us what an ADOs are, but how folks in that group think Kamala is not a true American Black person because she's not a descendant
of Black slaves. Oh, I want to answer that question anyway. Just stop reading it from there, Janet. We don't give a damn what people think. We don't care. If Kamala's Black is a question that I will not really entertain. Kamala is Black, and we know that she's Black, so if you all need to decide among yourselves what she is when white society actually decided that Black people is Black and how they became Black, whatever. I mean, I just cannot give y'all these history lessons. Everybody knows Kamala's Black. End of the story. Let's move on.
Thank you.
We got another question. Somebody wants to know. I'm going to hold off on that one so we can stay on topic. Here's one that somebody wants to know. How do we encourage young members of the African American community to join us in the field of education? Okay, so.
Oh my God.
Pay them better.
Not see a diverse enough group of teachers. Our teachers should look more like our student population.
Yeah, well, the first teacher that a Black child sees are their parents, their family members. Those are your first educators. I was Ariel's first teacher, and she would tell you that, and she's 34 years old. And so you're right. With integration, there was a group, a population of people like Senator Athena Joyner and the Fred Hearns of the world, when our schools were segregated, they were in Black spaces with Black educators from historically Black colleges. And those people are so darn smart. They're so smart, and they're pillars of the community. They're civil rights activists. Attending schools in Black spaces was wonderful for them, but integrating our society was also important, and that was a part of my generation. I integrated schools in second grade, and so therefore the diversity of my teachers changed, and And then you fast forward to my daughter's generation. I was so excited. It took for her to become a seventh grader to get a black teacher. And so I was really happy about that. She even came home and said, "Mom, my teacher is black." I'm like, "Yeah, I know, girl. I saw it in the open house." So anyway, it is important, but this is the entitlement generation. Kids are very savvy. They want to be paid. They want to be compensated. And so I wish, I could... We could have University of South Florida and Florida A&M and the other surrounding schools call in right now and say, "Hey, how many kids entered the College of Education at your schools?" We have teachers who come into this as second careers. We have folks that come into this because they think it's easy and they need a job, and we have 1,000 openings and they have some skills, but it is tough work. It is tough work, and the encouragement has to start with full ride scholarships to major in education. They cannot come out of college with debt that they can't pay back.
On those, yes. Yes. Those salaries,
supporting them for advanced degrees. Even our school district should do that. And some of them do for administrators, but we should do it for teachers as well. There has to be incentives. There are small towns that are providing living for their teachers. I don't know if you all saw this, but even Tampa General is building workforce housing.
Yeah.
Everything is competitive. Yeah. Everything is competitive. St. Pete is looking at workforce housing for it. So there's just so many different ways to answer that question, but you do have to provide the incentives, and we're going to get a natural group of people that just want to major in education.
We're going to talk more about affordable housing and workforce housing in a minute, but let's go to a call. We've got Joel calling from Venice. Joel, we love having somebody from Venice calling. You want to talk about teachers in Florida. What's on your mind?
Well, the state of education in Florida under Governor Romney, it's all about breaking the teachers' union. Everything that's happened in education, he wants to break the union. It's the biggest union in the state of Florida. He's a union buster.
Yeah.
That's all this is.
You know what?
Thank you, Joel.
Joel, that was his
Joel,
name?
Yep.
Yes, Joel.
Yeah, you're right. My heart is heavy when it comes to, you called him Ronnie. You sound like y'all are friends. I have to measure my words. I know that I'm on the radio. I'm going to have to measure my words because.
Oh, don't.
He is. Okay, Janet. I'll just say it this way. I'll say it cleanly. He's very dangerous to public education. Very dangerous, not just in the banning of books, but even, at the collegiate level. One of the things that he did was when the scores of the certifications came out for our colleges and schools, like our law school, Florida A&M University, which I'm a graduate of, he said that the pass rate was not high enough and that maybe we need to close the College of Education, College of Law at Florida A&M University. What he did not say, which is very interesting, is that we scored higher than Florida State University. But he did not mention closing their College of Law. He is a dangerous man. And as you can see, he doesn't do press conferences. He's not going to be asked questions. He's not going to be put in a tough situation where people get to piggyback. He does things in the dark. He slashes things. He came to Tampa and slashed the budget.
Well, we have another question about
He's
about
just
your
dangerous.
Friend Ron DeSantis, Ms. Henderson. This is from Bubba. Bubba, thanks for the email. We always love hearing from you every week. He says, "What do you think about DeSantis-backed Moms for Liberty style gadflies running for local school board races?" So we opened up the show talking about the school board races. We didn't really talk about that.
And there's some on the ballot.
There is some on the ballot, and we're just going to have to push back, and vote down the ballot. We have to vote. There's a book that came out by Dr. Bitcover. She was just here for the Kennedy King Gala, and her book is called Hit 'Em Where It Hurts. And this is how Democrats can beat the Republicans, and we have to beat them at their own game. So we have to put our people on the ballot. They put their people on the ballot. We have to put our people on the ballot. We have to put money behind them. We have to do that because that's what they do, and they've infiltrated at the local level up. And so,
school board races are increasingly, they're becoming that bench, the bench team. Yeah,
exactly. And but the beautiful part is they're showing us who they are. And so we have to fight back against that. Moms of Liberty are very dangerous. One of the books that's banned in the state of Florida is I Love My Hair. And it's not your hair, Janet. It's my hair.
Yep, yep.
Why do you even give a damn about my hair? And if I'm encouraging a young black girl to love her kinky, coily hair. But even that is a detriment to some white women, which is predominantly this group.
Why is that book banned? What is the illogic behind that?
Obviously, it makes
that?
Some little kid uncomfortable, you know? Mm. But, you know, it is. It can
we don't
be a
want
variety
kids to think,
reasons.
Huh? Hmm? Getting kids to think can be uncomfortable sometimes.
Yeah, or no, or even just the self-esteem of it all. The Ibram X. Kendi's book, How to Be an Anti-Racist.
Oh, well, probably the idea is that, yeah, okay, I see why book. It would...
Yeah,
this
you know,
world has
so,
made her feel bad about her hair, and so therefore we cannot talk about
that. No, not if you saw Whoopi Goldberg with a white one. Whoopi Goldberg became very famous. Do y'all remember she had a white towel on her hand because she wanted long straight hair? Remember that? Black women have had to work on themselves to love who we are, as we are, to love our hair because of what society put on us.
Right. Yes.
You know, so it takes a lot to be who we are, and that work still continues today. So the banning of books is just one of the big things that Moms of Liberty, you know, supports. And then, you know, even Ron DeSantis with getting behind not just school board members, but county commissioners as well. There's three recently appointed to county commission.
And state attorneys.
And state attorneys.
I just want to get back. Dave did message us. ADOS stands for American Descendants of Slavery. It appears that Trump is trying to appeal to these folks.
Trump can't appeal to black people.
There
are people that stand behind him. They get a couple of dollars to stand behind him and hold up signs. And there are some people who legitimately support,
right.
You know,
I'm
this
sorry,
radio.
That's okay. We're getting spicy
right
here.
You can't say BS.
No.
Sorry,
that's
BS.
One of the seven deadly words.
Y'all should have given me the words.
one of the things that you're passionate about is black history, but even more so is preserving black institutions so they don't become history.
Yay. Right? Oh, we're getting ready to talk about the Yellow Jackets.
Let's talk about the Yellow Jackets. is a little league that was in West Tampa until a previous administration, Bob Buckhorn's administration, decided it would be better to let a developer redevelop that land. So they kicked the Little League out of West Tampa, put them in Tampa Heights, and apparently...
Next to the graveyard.
According to a good story in the Tampa Bay Times recently, the Little League is not doing as well as they were previously. So can you talk about that?
Yeah, let's go back to the history part of it. Even before Yellow Jackets in that space, black spaces in the city of Tampa are almost non-existent. We have historical markers saying that we were once there. You know, the interstate bulldozed through our community. So if it is city, state, and local government that has desecrated black spaces. And so at this particular level, it takes someone in a seat like a city council person. You're sitting there and you're looking at what do you see when you're making decisions. It's not just about the land. It's about what you stand for. So from a historical perspective, in my role now is that anything that comes before me, if it is about preservation of a space, historical spaces like the Yellow Jackets, I'm going to fight to keep the Yellow Jackets. Sure, should we develop this land? If they're part of the development, yes, they can be inclusive. They can be a part of the development, but you can't have this space. You cannot have it. And so there had to be that philosophy needed to exist from the very beginning, and it needed to exist at the city council level, even though that's what Bob Buckhorn recommended. And he did have a conversation with the Yellow Jackets, and he did, you know, encourage them to take the space that they currently have and made promises that have not come to light. But having that conversation was the epic fail. When you think about 120 acres of riverfront property, did you really need the three or four or five that can make up a baseball field when you're building a housing development, when you're rebuilding a mixed-use community, multi-level income community? Having the park there would have been ideal because it's right down the street from Just, it's right down the street from Stewart, it's right down the street from Blake High School, their community, across the street from their Martin Luther King Recreation Center. It was perfect where it was. And here is what makes it really difficult. It's still sitting there. The baseball fence is still up where you can see where it was clearly a baseball field. So they made this promise, moved them right away, but the work hasn't even started. They literally could have stayed there until you made them whole. Mm-hmm. So here it is. If let's say they decided, okay, yeah, we'll leave. Okay, well, you make us whole. Make that a real baseball field, fix it up, let's do some good marketing or whatever, and we'll stay here until you get that all done. So this land has sat vacant and overgrown, and the community is saying, why couldn't we just stay there? Why? We want our field back. They're not even using it. Well, because a city council voted unanimously. That's what got me. Mm-hmm. Everybody? Because
the city council could have said no.
Could have said no. All you need is four. And I'm like, not one person could see the importance of preserving a mm-hmm. historical space. So that's why I'm an outlier. I am an outlier because that is not going to happen again. We just motion to move the sanitation department out of Carver City. That's where I grew up.
Okay.
The Carver City, and I'm saying this to a huge audience in Tampa, is Carver City is the best real estate in the city of Tampa. You can get to the airport, restaurants, sporting complexes. You can get to everything. My mom died at 93 with 20,000 miles on a car that was 25 years old.
Let's remind everybody about where that is.
So that is over in the West Shore area. Yeah. It's west part of town, north of Kennedy Boulevard. Yep. And across International Mall is a divider, West Shore. Yeah. That area on the other side of Delaware.
It often gets linked with Lincoln Gardens.
Carver City and Lincoln Gardens. Right. So now that's about 20 acres of land. A council member said recently, and this is my second time saying this, so I'm really excited. A council member said, yeah, well, we have the, you know, acreage over there, you know, and he didn't necessarily say Carver City. He said the sanitation department has about 20 acres. We could sell it for about $20 million. Hold up. Wait a minute. No, you cannot. The black community of Carver City and Lincoln Gardens will be the deciding factors of what happens with that land. It's a brownfield space, you know, because sanitation is moving. But that is an opportunity. That is an opportunity for a black community to create a space that is deserving of the population where we were forced to live. When my parents bought a house over there, this same city government was like, yeah, put the sanitation department over there in the black community. Mm-hmm. Yeah, put the jailhouse over there in the black community.
Yep.
You know, so that's what they did. And so now it's worth $20 million. Absolutely not. I'm saying it publicly for the second time. No. This is an opportunity to keep a space as black as it was when you gave it to us.
What's your vision for that property?
You know what? If it were up to me, it would be retail housing, definitely a social hub. We have our veteran cemetery right there. Mm-hmm. We really could just bring together with some bright ideas from the community that I grew up in, but a gathering space where we could recreate a small Central Avenue. I said it.
Well, that
with housing on top.
Brilliant idea. I mean, that is kind of hot real estate.
Absolutely.
Right?
It's very hot.
Development pressure.
It's very hot. And there are people thinking about it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
People are not afraid to gentrify spaces. But let's go back to the Yellow Jackets. Let me really hone in on this.
Because is there anything you can do about
that? Yes,
now?
I made a motion.
Great.
I made a motion for the developer, for staff to meet with the developers, and we can revise the community development agreement. We revised it for them. They came and asked for revisions on that development agreement. So
this is the related group?
The related group.
The related group.
So it goes both ways.
Yeah.
If they can ask for a revision, you can ask for a revision.
Yes. Oh. Yes.
Because they're going to be the beneficiaries of tens of millions of dollars in Riverwalk construction, right?
Exactly. Yeah, so you're going to make the Yellow Jackets whole. Well, I mean, that is my recommendation.
Are you getting support?
That's coming back September 5th.
Okay.
And I'm making a motion this Thursday to give an update before September 5th. And please do not plan to continue it.
your goal is to get the Yellow Jackets back where they were.
Rehabilitate the space that they're supposed to have.
Exactly. So the space that you gave
fulfill your promise.
Elevate it. Yes. Elevate it in a grand way, you know? So that's the related group, I do believe that they could do that. I do believe that they can make those adjustments. And I want to say this because it's really important. because now, you know, the inner city communities like Tampa Heights is gentrified in a sense, right? So these parents who move into the community, just like school districts, where you're zoned, your address says where you go to school, right? Okay, well, the Little League system is the same way. You live here, this is where you play baseball. So there are white families who move into these black spaces or mixed spaces, and now they say, oh yeah, you play for the Yellow Jackets, and the parents go, oh no, my kids can't play over there. So now you have a system where even the Yellow Jackets, these parents are going to South Tampa and North Tampa, and they're wanting a better place for their kids to play ball.
But the interesting history of that Yellow Jackets, there's an interesting history behind the formation of that, right? Didn't it rise out of the 1967 riots?
That's exactly on Central Avenue when a young man was killed by the police. That's exactly right.
Yeah.
And the Yellow Jackets came out of that to give young boys, something to engage them.
Yeah.
And it was for the neighborhood.
And
so
it was for the community.
It's no longer in the neighborhood.
And it's no longer in the neighborhood.
Right.
I heard somebody talk. I was talking to a planner yesterday about what they're doing in Jacksonville in some black neighborhoods up there. Mm-hmm. And he called it withentrification.
Regentrification.
He called it withentrification. Point being, you don't need to push people out and bring other people in. What you need to do is revitalize it with the people who are there.
Exactly. I live in Tampa Heights. I moved in 33 years ago, and of course now, and everybody thought I was crazy, but you know, I bought a house for $50,000 and you're paying now, you know, people are now paying $1 million to come into my community. Okay, fast forward, so my neighbors move in, and I had to say to one of my neighbors, that guy that you see going into my recycle bin, yeah, he can do that.
Yeah.
So don't you be calling the police. Because he can do that, and you should give him your cans too. Mm. Okay. You know, because I don't want you to think, because you're new to the community. You know, and I, as a city councilwoman, I have to talk to people all the time. You know, they're complaining about things that you move in and you want things to change. And some change is good. Some change is good, but not at the expense of the people that currently exist.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so,
and I'll just leave it at that.
We're talking about redevelopment, and you, in your first year on the city council, you were elected chair of the Community Redevelopment Agency, which is quite a powerful, it's the city council serving as the Community Redevelopment Agency. And what the Community Redevelopment District does is any increase in property tax revenue that goes...
is reinvested back into that
district, as opposed to other parts of the city.
Yeah.
And so I'm curious how you feel about... And it has to be a blighted community, right? It's supposed to be...
Slum and blight. That was the whole reason for community redevelopment. Really, it's one of those kind of racial reconciliation deals. That's why CRA existed. And East Tampa just happens to be the largest CRA in the state of Florida.
Oh, really?
It's the largest CRA in the state of Florida, and in terms of geographical space.
And so what's your vision for that? Because you not only are the chair of the CRA, you represent... East Tampa?
Five of the CRAs are in my district.
Ah. So what is your vision for the East Tampa Community Redevelopment District, which has, I think, about $15 million or maybe more? Yeah. What do you think should be done with that district going forward?
Okay. So this is a situation where I have to measure myself. Well, because I'm also an educator, and I've had to educate even the community. And sometimes I say things that they don't like, but it happens to be true. So the board, this is a true statement. The board is the decider of what happens.
CRA board.
Yeah. See, that was the sentence.
Yeah,
with the period.
The mayor's office.
Not the mayor's office, and not necessarily even, you know, folks in the community.
The advisory boards and all that sort of thing.
They're called the CAC. So we wanted to buy a piece of property recently over in East Tampa, and the CAC board, you know, voted no, and we bought it anyway.
Right.
You know, so they don't like that. But we're rounding out a 5-acre piece of land that they're now, I believe, on board with. You know, so sometimes
to do what
pushing.
With? What's the plan for that?
Housing.
Housing. Okay.
Housing, yeah.
Janet said we were going to talk about affordable housing.
So yeah, a big part of workforce housing.
If we don't buy the land, if the developers get the land, they get to decide, right? So we have to be in this business and put out the RFP, you know, to make things happen so that we can say it has to be this. This is what we want. Based on community input, that's where the CACs become very important and reliable, because it's also about what they want in their community. The one thing that the community does struggle with, and I understand this clearly, is implementation. It takes things a long time. Well before even Fair Oaks was, you know, a part of my life as a council member, they have been working on that for years.
That's a community center in East Tampa.
That's the $41 million community center that some people are very upset about, even on council, that did not support it. But that's okay, because
the price went up or doubled.
The price went up, but, you know, that happens across the board, or because it's bonded. But we bond other things. We have a AAA bonding. The city's in great shape. We have good money saved, well beyond our reserves are good. And so this is one of these, once again, black spaces that we're making whole as a city. This is going to be an award-winning park in the center of East Tampa. And I can't wait for the community to see it. The entire city of Tampa is what I'm talking about. So back to CRA, yes, we make decisions that are going to change areas of slum and blight, and that's really important, and that is the focus. Although we have given funding to city assets like the Straz and the Florida Aquarium and the Tampa Museum, we have given funding to those in the downtown area.
So that's the question. So we talked about CRAs are all about slum and blight. Mm-hmm. That's what they're supposed to be, is turnaround communities. Yeah. And so we just renewed it. Looks like the CRAs for downtown and the Channel District, which so they're going to
No, they're not renewed. They all have a shelf life, and we have a few years left. See, I wish I had my notes in front of me, but those CRAs are set to expire in May, 8 to 10 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what do you think about continuing those? Does downtown and the Channel District still need those CRAs?
Because
tens of millions of dollars.
It is.
$27 million in the downtown CRA alone that could be spent in other parts of the city.
Okay, well, that's how some people feel. But remember, the tax base is based on, you know, the place where you live, right? So downtown, when you look at it, we've come a long way, right? You see Channel Side and you see them and they look great. They don't need any help.
Right.
Well, yes, they still do need help. You know, we still are making things whole in these spaces. For example, in downtown, we brought the Army Navy store right off the interstate.
Yep.
You remember that?
Yep.
Okay. So that's a property that's owned by the city that we're redeveloping and hoping, you know.
What were they putting there? Is that going to be workforce
housing?
That's
what we're in the process of doing right now. I'm waiting for the RFP to come across my desk very soon.
You want it to be housing, right?
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Mixed use, you know, mixed income housing. Because our workers who work in coffee shops, notice I did not name a coffee shop.
Yeah.
You know, whatever. But a coffee shop or a bookstore. Or
the hotels.
Or a restaurant. Yes. They deserve to live in the city. They should not be having to commute from Waimama and Riverview and all of these other outskirt places.
Because they can't afford to live in Tampa,
correct,
right?
Yeah. Correct. So that's why it's still needed. You may not see slum and blight on every single corner anymore, but there's still work to be done. And so that's why those CRA dollars should remain there.
Okay.
And I know that other people feel differently, and you are entitled to your opinion.
Well, I think some people...
Because everything takes four votes, by the way.
People who live in outside of these districts see all the development that's going
on,
particularly downtown, Water Street, Channel District, and all the money that's now flowing into those districts, and wondering, well, why can't some of it be spent to repave some of our roads? For example... Ybor City, they just bricked a couple of blocks of 7th
section
Avenue.
Section by section, right?
Yep.
Pay as you go.
And so some people are saying, great, great idea. It's going to be more historic. Other people are saying, wait a minute. You've got streets all around 7th Avenue that need to be repaved. What about those streets?
You know what? I'm so glad you asked me that question. Okay, and this is my personal opinion. And remember, it takes four votes.
Yep.
And I'm just one. But we still have a housing crisis, right? But does the city of Tampa need to put all of the funding into housing? No. I'm going to answer this very simplistically. We have to spread the wealth. So we are still a tourist city. So we have to think about that. We still have slum and blight. We have to think about that. We have spaces where developers come in and they are, you know, investing their funds, like the gas work area that's getting ready to go up.
Mm-hmm.
Or we could just let it sit there. Or even the sidewalks in Ybor City. Remember, Central Avenue is gone.
Now, the West Tampa has a community redevelopment
district. Yes, West Tampa, yes.
Is that something that you could use to help the Yellow Jackets? Or what's your vision for the West Tampa district?
No, I already made the motion, the related group. Yeah.
Okay. The related group should
the
pay for it.
The related group, yeah.
Your vision then for the West Tampa district to spend that money? I understand there's been some talk about shifting some of that money to the Riverwalk or something like that.
We've already voted for the Riverwalk. Last week we voted to extend the Riverwalk all the way through West Tampa. And, you know, I think it was five to two.
Is that CRA money or city money?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're in the final seconds of our show. Okay, I want you to mention your bookstore.
Okay.
Tell us where the bookstore is and what your focus is.
Okay, so the name of my bookstore is Black English Bookstore. Shout out to James Baldwin. This is his centennial, 1924 to 2024. His birthday was last week. I named the bookstore after him because he wrote an essay entitled "If Black English Is Not a Language, Then Tell Me What Is."
And where is it located? Because we have to wrap up.
401 East Oak Avenue in Tampa Heights, right down the street from Armature Works.
There you go. Thanks very much.
Oh, man. Stay tuned.
I know. See how quickly the time flies.
Up next is NPR News, followed by Wide Awake America with Nadine Smith. She will be talking to David Hogg, the survivor of the Parkland school shooting, and they will be talking about the March for Our Lives movement. This is WMNF Tampa.